It's Friday, 23 August. My name's Juan Brown. You're watching the Blanco Lirio channel, and it's been a very busy week in aviation here at the Blanco Lirio Global Hangar headquarters. And once again, we have another situation that occurred just this morning on the cover of the national news, or the lead story on the national news this morning was Hawaiian Airlines Flight 47 emergency landing in Honolulu with smoke in the cabin. I've been flying for 40 years, you know the resume, commercial, military, civilian, but I also got an airframe and power plant mechanics license. So today we're going to review what the crew of Hawaiian Airlines Flight 47 was facing with this smoke in the cabin situation just 20 minutes prior to landing. We'll look at some of those checklists, but we'll also review some basic systems knowledge of how these aircraft are pressurized and how smoke from the air conditioning system can get into, or how smoke can get into the air conditioning system and into the cabin of the aircraft. We'll also review emergency evacuation procedures and use of, or not the use of, passenger oxygen masks. We'll also discuss some new technology that's going to make, hopefully, these sort of emergencies obsolete. First, we'll start with the facts as we know them from the Aviation Herald put out by Simon Radecki. A Hawaiian Airlines Airbus A321-200N, registration November 218, Hotel Alpha, performing flight as Hawaiian Airlines Flight 47 from Oakland to Honolulu with 184 passengers and 7 crew, was descending towards Honolulu about 20 minutes prior to landing when odor and smoke appeared on board, prompting the flight crew to don their oxygen masks, declare an emergency, accelerate their approach and landing into Honolulu. The crew advised they plan to stop on the runway and evacuate. The aircraft landed safely on runway 04 about 20 minutes later. The aircraft stopped on the runway. It was evacuated via the slides. Emergency service didn't find any trace of fire or heat. 7 people were taken to the hospital, I suspect from the emergency evacuation, not from any smoke inhalation, but I'm not sure on that. Passengers reported the crew indicated smoke in the cargo hold, we'll talk more about that in a minute, initially, and discharged fire suppression there. Then smoke developed in the cabin. Flight attendants donned their smoke hoods. We'll talk more about that in a minute. The airline reported the crew declared an emergency about 20 minutes prior to landing due to the smoke in the cargo hold in the cabin. It was subsequently determined that a seal in the left-hand engine had failed, permitting oil to leak onto hot parts of the engine and air conditioning system. That's the part we'll discuss from a mechanic's point of view. The performance of the engine was not affected. Emergency services assisted in the emergency evacuation. Seven passengers were taken to hospital with smoke-related symptoms. So it was smoke-related, not necessarily from the emergency evacuation. 184 passengers and 7 crew on board. Typically, when you have, there's nothing more frightening to an air crew member than the thought of a fire on board an aircraft or smoke and fumes on an aircraft. It represents a daunting challenge to air crew members as you try to sort out the source of this possible smoke and fire, going through a plethora of checklists, getting them done correctly and in the correct order, but most importantly, getting your oxygen mask on as a pilot or crew member, getting it on 100%, establishing communications, and beginning a descent as fast as you can to the nearest suitable airport. These are lessons that were learned very hard from the Swissair Flight 111 accident back in 1998, fire on board the aircraft. Now let's break this down a little bit. 20 minutes out from landing in Honolulu, the flight crew of Hawaiian Airlines Flight 47 gets their first indication of some sort of smoke in the cabin or smoke or fire related issue. In the cargo compartment of modern airliners is a smoke detector, a photoelectric smoke detector that uses light to detect smoke. If you get smoke in the air conditioning system, it may very well get into the cargo compartment as well and fire off those cargo fire detectors. So perhaps the first indication in the cockpit that this crew had a problem was either A, maybe a call from a flight attendant in the back, or B, possibly a cargo fire illumination or a cargo fire indication. A cargo fire indication is a pretty simple procedure to deal with. You simply raise the red guarded switch and arm and then press the cargo fire discharge button, and the cargo fire suppression system begins to work automatically. Upon completing this checklist, the smoke and fumes persisted in the cabin. Now, as a crew member, hopefully you already have your oxygen mask on, you're on 100% oxygen, and you've established communications. That in itself is a huge pain in the rear end. The big bulky mask and communication is garbled and muffled, plus you've got a visor over your eyes blocking your peripheral vision and making it even hard sometimes to see the instruments. Remember, the pilot's oxygen supply is separate from everybody else. They have a couple of oxygen tanks up there, pressurized to provide several hours of 100% pure oxygen. The flight attendants in the back have air bottles that they can walk around with and or smoke hoods that they can put on and completely cover their whole heads and provide them 15 to 20 minutes of oxygen and smoke-free vision. Now facing the crew is, what checklist do we run? What problem is causing this smoke? How do we troubleshoot this to determine the source of this smoke? Well, the crew did the right thing by just initially declaring the emergency, started a descent, and get headed to Honolulu, just 20 minutes away, and get there as quick as you can. Here's the actual track on Flight Radar 24 showing a right downwind pattern entry for 8 left to get pointed into the trade winds. Because these checklists and sorting out which checklist to run and what the source of the smoke is can take a lot of time. Determining the source of this smoke is going to require a lot of communications and some experience, and some experience may tell you that smoke from the air conditioning system is a bit more common than electrical fire on board one of these aircraft. By communicating with the crew in the back of the aircraft and getting some feedback from them as to what does the smoke smell like, where is it coming from, can help you troubleshoot this situation and direct you towards the correct checklist procedure. An electrical fire will typically smell like an electrical fire and will typically be started in one local area. Smoke from the air conditioning system, caused by a blown seal on the engine, which we'll talk about in a minute, will be coming through the gasper vents, through all the vents. It'll look a lot like a vapor that you see when you're getting ready to depart a humid environment and the cabin condenses with thick, dense vapor. However, this smoke from the air conditioning system will have a very acrid smell to it and perhaps smell like a really bad case of dirty socks. Often that dirty sock smell is related to a filter that needs replacing in the air conditioning system. Once you've determined that this is a problem with the air conditioning system, you need to start troubleshooting the air conditioning system. If you determine that it's a possible electrical problem, you need to start troubleshooting the electrical system and start powering down different phases of the electrical system to try to isolate the cause. This is all done by following the correct checklist. Why and how does smoke get into the air conditioning system? All aircraft are pressurized. How are these aircraft pressurized? They're pressurized using bleed air from the compressor section of the engine. High pressure bleed air run through two air cycle machines that produces an excessive amount of air to fill up the cabin, to fill up the balloon of the cabin, and that air is regulated with an outflow valve located in the back of the aircraft. This keeps the cabin altitude of your average airliner at about 8,000 feet pressure altitude while the aircraft is cruising as high as 35,000 feet. Since most modern airliners have two engines plus an APU, they typically have two air conditioner units or two packs that pressurize the aircraft. Either of these two packs can provide enough air to pressurize the aircraft. As the crew is troubleshooting the air conditioning system, they need to start depowering these packs one at a time to see if they can get the smoke to dissipate. They may need to do an emergency descent all the way down to a habitable altitude of around 10,000 feet in order to completely depressurize the aircraft and eliminate all the smoke from the aircraft. If in the event that the checklist drives them to perform an emergency descent, the rubber jungle will deploy. In other words, the passenger oxygen masks will be deployed. They'll either be deployed manually by the crew or as they turn off the air conditioner packs, both of them, and the cabin altitude exceeds 14,000 feet, the passenger oxygen masks will automatically deploy. In this case, the crew was already descending into Honolulu fast enough and troubleshooting the system to where they were able to keep the aircraft pressurized enough to where they didn't have to deploy the passenger oxygen masks. Remember, the passenger oxygen masks are there for an emergency descent. The passenger oxygen masks are not there for smoke and fumes. Why? Because the passenger oxygen masks blend the oxygen that is generated by the emergency generators with cabin air. So even if the oxygen masks were deployed and you had them on properly and were breathing that oxygen would be blended with cabin air through the little yellow Dixie cup. Remember too about passenger oxygen is the passenger oxygen is provided by a oxygen generator, a chemical reaction of sodium chloride and iron in the overhead bin there. That's why you got to pull on the oxygen hose to fire the trigger to initiate the reaction in the canister overhead to get your oxygen flowing in your mask. Remember too, that bag's not going to completely inflate while you're exhaling. That oxygen's flowing 100% of the time, and that bag, that leftover oxygen that you're not breathing while you're exhaling will go into the bag. So some bags may inflate, some bags may be completely flat. It doesn't matter. The oxygen is flowing just fine.
Unless you're wearing your oxygen masks like this, please pay attention to the flight attendant's pre-flight briefing.
Now let's talk about how smoke and fumes can get into the air conditioning system via the bleed air system from the engine from a blown seal. Right here on the nose of the Mighty Luscombe is a crankshaft seal. It keeps the oil inside the engine with a simple contact chevron type seal that rubs against the crankshaft itself. How do I know when that seal is blown? When oil droplets begin to cover the windshield.
As the oil is blown back by the prop.
Modern airliners use a much more complex and sophisticated seal called a labyrinth seal. Let's check that out.
Fresh, clean bleed air for the pressurization and air conditioning system is extracted from two places along the compressor section of the engine, well ahead of the turbine section where combustion takes place. Jet engines rotate on bearings that are cooled and lubricated by synthetic engine oil under pressure.
These bearings are protected by labyrinth seals, which keeps the oil inside the core of the engine. These seals come in a lot of different shapes and sizes and provide a labyrinth of seals to prevent fluid from escaping. Often these labyrinths are pressurized by bleed air to provide an even better seal.
As air passes through the compressor section, it gets hot, very hot. So if one of these seals fails in the compressor section, that oil is going to turn to smoke and enter the pressurization and air conditioning system via the bleed air system.
All right, fair enough, but I know what you're thinking. What if this didn't happen 20 minutes out of Honolulu, but what if it happened halfway across the Pacific? Flight planning to Hawaii is unique because the route from the west coast of the United States to Hawaii represents one of the longest single routes without a suitable alternate airport. So for each and every flight from the west coast to the United States to Hawaii, there is calculated an equal time point. It's not an equal distance point, it's an equal time point that takes into account the winds, particularly the jet streams aloft. With this equal time point, you're able to calculate the worst case scenario. What's the worst case scenario halfway across the pond? Is it an engine failure and you have to descend down to a single engine service ceiling and operate in? No, it's this particular situation where you have to depressurize the aircraft, or the aircraft becomes depressurized and you need to descend all the way down to 10,000 feet and then continue on to your destination. Jet engines are flat-rated engines. They are designed to operate most efficiently up at altitude. If you're forced down to 10,000 feet, that jet engine is burning a heck of a lot more fuel, and you're moving at a much slower ground speed in the thicker air at 10,000 feet. So every single flight to Hawaii is fuel planned for this worst-case scenario. Now that means you're tankering a bit of extra fuel every time you go to Hawaii, and you're going to be landing with quite a bit of fuel once you get to Hawaii, and that costs everybody a little bit of money. Each time you tanker fuel through, that amount of fuel that you're tankering costs you about 3% of your fuel burn to carry it. If you get out there to islands like Kauai with shorter runways, by the time you load up all your passengers and all your fuel that you need to make this requirement, you may find yourself sitting in the terminal without a seat on the airplane, even though there's empty seats on the airplane, because once you've got all this weight loaded on the aircraft, you can no longer meet the runway requirements for the shorter runways on islands like Kauai. Current technology is making these sort of smoke and fume events non-existent by getting away from the use of bleed air to pressurize the aircraft completely. The brand new Boeing 787 Dreamliner, an all-electric jet, uses electric power and compressors to pressurize the aircraft and does not use bleed air at all to pressurize the aircraft. On the 787 now, they're able to much improve the health and safety of the passengers by providing a much lower cabin altitude, something like about 6,000 feet, and virtually eliminate the possibility of smoke and fumes from the engine getting into the air conditioning system and into the cabin. That's why I'm considering, when I go back on the line after my little medical hiatus here, of switching from the 777 to the 787. And learn a whole new aircraft and get trained up on some of the latest technology. By the way, the pay's the same for a pilot between the 777 and the 787. The routes are almost the same. The 787 at our airline has taken a lot of the routes that the 777 used to fly, so I'll enjoy going to some different places, though I would miss going to London. I hope this helps you understand a little more about what went on with Hawaiian Air. I want you to please pay attention to the flight attendants on their pre-departure briefing and think about some of that we've learned about the use of oxygen masks, what it's good for and what it's not good for. Wear proper footwear, keep your feet off the furniture. See you here.